She has been all over this in the offseason. Good stuff, Jane. But I want to know, what's the latest?
I wish I had some updates for you guys. Good to see you. I was talking to you guys during the break. You guys have been some of the hardest working people through COVID and with sports. But now we have a lot of news to talk about on this Dak situation. So it's my understanding that they haven't had any meaningful conversations. It's been very quiet since they slapped the franchise tag on Dak. And since then, the phones have not been ringing, which gives me the sense that it's not going to be a situation like we saw with Ezekiel Elliott, where essentially Zeke got back from Cabo, told Rocky Arsenault, his agent, pick up the phone, let's get a deal done, and they did it at the 11th hour. This really feels like the two sides are digging in. And as it was described to me, the offer that was last on the table and the one that remains was anywhere between $33 and $35 million a year with a guarantee that's close to about Jared Goff's, about $110 million guaranteed. Now, he signed the franchise tag, so he's already locked in at 31.4. And then, of course, if they franchise tag him again next year, he's looking at $37 million. So that's where it stands right now. And that sticking point continues to be that 4 years for Dak. Cowboys want five because they believe they're giving him a top-of-the-market offer, and they want that extra year so that they can, as you guys know, front load that money and have a little room to play with it. He wants to be able to start talking about a new deal in year three. They want to start talking about it in year four.
So, Jane, of that 100 plus million that you reported, maybe 110-ish, Jared Goff-ish sort of 110, do you have any idea how much is what they call guaranteed at signing? It's the real guarantee. Like Goff got 57 guaranteed at signing. Wentz got 66.4 guaranteed at signing. That's the money you can really take to the bank.
Well, I don't have the offer sheet in front of me, but as it was described to me, Skip, we're talking about 85 plus. And well, so that's what they call a rolling guarantee these days.
Okay. All right.
And then ultimately, then all of it, 110. But that is what I'm being told the number is currently at. And so, look, I think you could argue this thing two different ways. You could take the Kirk Cousins approach, which is seemingly what Todd France and Dak Prescott are doing here. When I looked at the numbers, you know, if Cousins plays through this contract, of course, he just got the two-year extension that gave him another $66 million on this. He's looking to make $196.4 million. Not bad when you consider Russell Wilson, who's also in his draft class, what he's been able to do. And he was also a fourth-round pick like Dak. But then you can also look at this another way, where essentially you could have long-term security at this point. You don't know what it's going to look like next year. You don't know really what this cap is going to be in. Well, the gambling revenue is likely not going to be affected. The TV money, which again is why they keep honing in on this year three as it pertains to this contract with the four-year deal, at least gives you some security. I started polling a lot of agents that have worked with the Cowboys on some of these deals in the past, and I asked them, what do you guys think? I'm just curious. You've dealt with them in the past. And one agent brought up to me the Anthony Spencer contract, and Skip, you might remember this. They franchise tagged him as a young lineman, thought that the number they franchise tagged him was more than the APY. But then when he played, he didn't have that great of the season. Neither did the Cowboys. I was told they were thinking about not even franchise tagging him. He gets tagged again, and then he injures himself. And for the large part, we saw his career sort of fizzle out. Now, I'm not saying that's going to necessarily be the case with Dak Prescott, but you really are gambling on yourself. Now, he's played 64 regular season games. He's incredibly durable. He's taken him to three playoff games. He's won one. And this is a guy that's always bet on himself. Going back to high school, college, and the pros, you know, every time a starter got hurt, he got the job, never gave it back. And he's done an admirable job in Dallas. And I also think that he plays better with a bit of a chip on his shoulder, but it still is a little bit of a gamble.
Yeah, but Jane, here's the thing. You look at Goff and you look at Wentz, they got their deals done with 2 years left. So Jerry wants a five-year deal, and he wants a deal at his number. So shouldn't Jerry be willing to concede something? Because Dak has no more years. Those other guys signed four-year extensions, which basically was the 2 years plus four, that's six. Well, if you want Dak, Dak has no years. So Dak should get 15, 20% more than what Jared Goff got in guaranteed money. If Jerry wants the 5 years, he has to be willing to concede something because he didn't give Dak the security that those other organizations gave those quarterbacks.
You know, to your point, I hear you, Shannon, but I the Cowboys, at least their position maintains it. They feel, for a guy that hasn't gone to a championship game yet, for a guy that was a fourth round pick, for a guy, and I don't love this argument that you're in Dallas and you can make up the money. I know there have been people that have talked to him about that. You can make all this money, those Oikos contracts, don't happen if you're with the Buffalo Bills necessarily. They happen when you're in Dallas. And we've also seen how guys like Cam and Jameis, they tides turn. Mm-hmm. But they feel like given the number that this is fair market value. I mean, we're not talking that they've necessarily disrespected him with this contract. But to your point, yes, I think we can all agree the Cowboys wouldn't have found themselves in this situation if they had gotten this thing done 2 years ago, before the Jared Goff situation and before the Carson Wentz deal. But they certainly don't feel like he's anywhere in the stratosphere of Patrick Mahomes. So they feel like they're putting him right up there with the Russell Wilson numbers, and they feel like that's pretty respectable. Mm.
So, Jane, as you well know, not much communication for a long time. Not like Jerry Jones, who always says deadlines make deals. So I thought maybe I was hoping against hope that last night they would feverishly negotiate and maybe by now they'd be very close to compromising, finding some new middle ground and make a deal. Do you read anything negative into that? Is there any animosity that has developed on either side versus the other side over the last 3, 4, 5 months?
It's not a bad question. And I think for the locker room and especially the players, you have to wonder, okay, we saw how acrimonious this thing got with DeMarcus Lawrence. We saw how tense this thing got with Ezekiel Elliott. The difference was that ultimately the players bended a little bit. They picked up the phone. They were able to get a deal done.
Yep.
Todd France and Dak's side have not bent at all, and they've made their position known. I thought it was interesting. I pulled up an interview even from last year talking to Dak Prescott when they first made their offer and then the counteroffer. And he said, you know, I'm just learning the process. I knew it, how these deals, I would imagine that he's learned a lot about this. But for those wondering if this is going to be a distraction, what I've seen with Dak is this is a guy that is such a consummate professional. I think that's why it's also hard for some people to sort of grasp this. He's done everything right, both on the field and off of it. We saw the way that he galvanized this team with Tony Romo, who got injured, came back healthy, wasn't even able to compete for his job because he was so admirable as a starter. We saw the way he navigated with a tight end by committee, a wide receiver by committee, with the Ezekiel Elliott suspension. For a lot of people, they feel like, well, you've overpaid players for years. Why not the one guy that actually deserves it? Unfortunately, I think you have two things happening here. You finally have a front office that's saying to themselves, we can't keep getting ourselves in what they used to call cap hell around here.
Yeah.
And we're not going to be able to go to a Super Bowl if we continue to overpay players. And they said that even with the Ezekiel Elliott deal, we were talking about this last summer, guys, you can't overpay these players, but they feel like they're not disrespecting him and they're also not overpaying him. They're paying what they believe is the market value. So I also think what's unfortunate here is we're talking a pandemic. A lot of people are losing their jobs. A lot of people are marinating on these numbers. If there wasn't a pandemic, I don't think we'd even be talking about Dak and his money. But people, unfortunately, are now creating this narrative that Dak is somehow greedy for not taking this deal. Mm-hmm. He's banking on himself. And you also have to consider, this is a guy who made less than $5 million his first 4 years playing. $31.4 million is a lot of money for a guy like Dak, who also has advertising deals and insurance policy on the table, but again, is continuing to bank on himself and see if he can't get more money. No different than I think a lot of us would do if we were in a similar position.
Jane, can I ask you a question? When Dak was making $400,000, $500,000 winning Rookie of the Year and going 13-3, did anybody in the Cowboy organization think he was underpaid?
You know, that's a great question. It's not one that I asked. I'm sure that they did feel that way, but I also would probably venture to guess that they feel like, hey, you were a fourth-round pick, and we literally said goodbye to our heir apparent, a guy that vacationed with the Jones family that was like a son, and we have put you in this role. I bet if you ask Dak Prescott, well, he has always banked on himself, do you see yourself in a position to make this sort of money 5 years later? I don't know if any of us analysts or if even Dak would have considered himself, but I don't think that's fair to even go down that road, because he certainly has deserved the money that we're talking about, the way that he's played and what he's done for this organization. If you ask any of his teammates, they certainly want to see him as the franchise guy.
See, the problem that I have, Jane, is that you keep mentioning every time a fourth-round pick, and that's how the Cowboys view him. If Dak Prescott was a first-round pick, we would not even have this discussion. They'd have gave Dak Prescott his money. If Dak Prescott was a first-round pick, if he was Jared Goff, Carson Wentz, and he had gone to two playoff games, if he was Rookie of the Year, this would not even be an issue. They still see him as that fourth-round pick. They are unsure. Don't let anybody tell you, I played the game, Skip covered the game. When they put that tag on you, they're saying, we're not sure. They didn't put the tag on Wentz. They didn't put the tag on Goff. They didn't put the tag on my homeboy. They put it on Dak, and they didn't get the deal done early. And I said, and I told Skip, I said, Skip, the mistake they're making is that when Wentz come up and when Goff come up and all these other quarterbacks, Dak's going to start like, well, whoa, they're coming up with deals, and they got 2 years left. I got none. I'm not giving you a discount, Jerry, and that's what happened.
But, Shannon, something that I've always been told, even in my own line of work, your bosses typically see you how you come in as. And sometimes you have to go somewhere else mm-hmm. for people to recognize your value. Now, I would hate to see him have to go somewhere like the Buffalo Bills for people to recognize Dak's value. Those of us that cover him, talking to his teammates, we know what his value is. And I believe that the Cowboys know what his value is, too. And again, this is not a disrespectful offer if you look at the numbers. And they have tried to get a deal done with him since last year. But they have maintained that they think that this is his market value. And this is, again, just shrewd business, both on the side of the agent and the players. But let's not get it twisted. Again, it's not like they're not offering him good money here either.
But see, we're looking at it from our perspective, Jane. You know, that's great money for you and I. But when he looks at what Patrick Mahomes just got, he's looking at Deshaun Watson about to come behind him, and he's looking at Lamar Jackson. He's like 35. They're going to zoom past that. And here I am going to be looking at here. I'm the next guy up. I take 35, and here comes Deshaun Watson coming. He's about to get 40. Lamar Jackson, he plays well again. He's going to be in the 40s. And here I was, the next guy up, and I took in the 30s. You can't. I tell people, you have to look at it how the athlete and how professional athletes. Yeah, $34 million to you and I. Man, we'd have done signed that contract, Jane, last year.
Oh, 100%. But I also think if he had taken them to an NFC championship game, we wouldn't even be having this conversation either. And as Jerry has pointed out, he doesn't get cramps writing checks. And he's pointed out that if you take him to the Super Bowl, he's got no problem opening up that pocketbook and paying whatever. And this could actually end up costing the Cowboys quite a bit of money if they keep doing this franchise tag. But here's what I will say. $31.4 million is what he's guaranteed to make regardless if he doesn't sign this franchise tag by 3 o'clock Central Time today. And the Cowboys, with a new coaching staff, get the opportunity to also evaluate if this is the quarterback that Mike McCarthy wants to move forward with in the future. This is a guy who wasn't there for the virtual offseason, learning the terminology. And while I don't think that Dak's the type of guy that's going to struggle with that by any stretch of the means, it does give everybody sort of this opportunity to, one's making money, they've got low risk here, and everyone can go to their corners. So again, I've gone back and forth with this thing. I think you could argue two different ways. If the money was lower than what I'm being told it is, then I would say it's disrespectful. But the money is top of the market money.
Jane, let me ask you a question.
The sticking point, again, is this 4- and 5-year right. deal, which, again, the Cowboys have never done a 4-year deal with a marquee player. I had our research look at this. They have never done a 4-year deal with a marquee player. And they feel like if they set a precedent with this, they're going to have to continue to do this. They front load the money. They want to start talking about that new contract for him in year 4 as opposed to 5.
Jane, they already set a precedent. Tony Romo didn't go to no NFC championship game, and they made him the highest paid quarterback.
Tony Romo always comes in the discussion.
Yeah, it should. He got it. You set a precedent. You the one that used the word precedent. They never signed 5-4-year deals. That's precedent. Tony Romo never went to the NFC championship game. That's precedent.
All right.
I thought Skip actually had a really great point about the son theory. There is not the same relationship that we saw Tony Romo and Jerry with Dak. And I actually think that's a good thing. I think we realized how messy that got for them when they had to make tough decisions.
Yep.
Huh. Interesting.
Thank you, Jane.
Great stuff. Honestly, appreciate it. I've been watching your social media to see if we have any movement later. Thank you for joining us. We will chat with you soon. Thank you for watching. You can subscribe here to get the latest from the show, and be sure to check out more of the best clips from Undisputed, or go watch a few other segments from our other shows on FS1.